Welcome to the third round of the 8th Annual St. Clair County High School Mock Trial Competition. Prior to getting started, I want to remind everyone to please turn off your cell phone and electronic devices because these proceedings will be recorded. Before we get started, we are going to have some introductions. First of all, we are going to have Captain Ron Muxlow introduce himself, and he's going to tell you a little bit about himself.
Okay, my name is Captain Ron Muxlow of the St. Clair County Sheriff's Office. I work for Sheriff Tim Donnellan. I've been a police officer for a little over 32 years. I attended SC4 at Ferris State University. I'm also a graduate of Eastern Michigan University School of Staff and Command and the National FBI Academy in Quantico, Virginia. My present assignment is at the Sheriff Department. I oversee the Road Patrol Division, the Drug Task Force, the Marine Patrol Division, and the Animal Control Division. And again, it's a pleasure to be here, and I look forward to your presentations. Thank you.
Thank you. We also have some distinguished judges here in the courtroom, starting with Judge Tom Buckley.
Good afternoon. My name is Tom Buckley. I'm the Undersheriff with St. Clair County Sheriff's Office. I've been with the office just over 22 years. I have served as a bailiff in these proceedings a few times, but this is my first time as a judge. I'm really looking forward to what you guys have to offer today. I wish you the best of luck.
Thank you, Judge Armstrong.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Mona Armstrong. I'm a senior assistant prosecuting attorney here in St. Clair County. And I've been an attorney for just about 19 years and spend most of my time doing trial work. So I love doing it. I hope you've enjoyed getting ready for this last round, and I wish you the best of luck in what you're about to do.
Thank you, Judge Brinker.
Good afternoon. My name is Colleen Brinker. I'm an attorney. I do most of my work down in the probate court. I look forward to being here every year. I don't think I've missed one of these yet. It's a joy to be here and watch the dedication that you put into this. Good luck. Third time's a charm.
Thank you. Judge Davidson.
My name is Mark Davidson. I'm an attorney here practicing in Fort Huron. I was sworn into my attorney official swearing-in ceremony in this very room in 1975, so that makes 37 years I've been doing this. It's my 8th year. I've been a judge in this competition every year since it started, and it's just really my honor and thrill to do this every year. I really do enjoy it. I am a civil litigator attorney also, and have done lots of trials in these rooms, and I'm always very gratified to see how well you, who haven't been to law school yet, even perform. So good luck to you. And I know this is the afternoon now, so you've got two rounds under your belt, so we really want to see good shows.
Judge Stremmers.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Greg Stremmers. I'm a civil trial attorney. Been practicing 20 years in St. Clair County, and 8 years I've been participating in this, and it's a great event to come to. I really appreciate all the hard work you put into this. My first trial was in this courtroom right here, so I know I felt those nerves, and I'm sure you're going to do a great job.
Thank you. Judge Easton.
I'm Bill Easton, a mostly retired attorney, and glad to see all these young faces here.
And my name is Melissa Keys. I'm a senior assistant prosecutor here in St. Clair County. I've been with the office for about 16 years. I'm currently assigned to the Drug Task Force, and I also handle major crimes that happen in our county. So we are really excited to see what you have to offer. So let's get started with round three. Will the parties please state their appearances on the record for the plaintiff?
Hi, I'm Samantha Bynum. I'm going to be directing Phoenix Perdante, and I'm going to be crossing Salvester, and I'm going to be doing the closing argument.
Thank you.
My name is Madison Southers. I'll be directing Charlie Connor and crossing Joe Serpico.
Thank you.
My name is Adam Freeman. I will be directing Sterling Morton, and I will be crossing MJ Hinken, and I will be also reading the opening statement.
Thank you. Can the witnesses also identify themselves?
My name is Dakota Carter. I will be playing the part of Phoenix Perdante.
Good.
My name is Keenan Kurtz. I'll be playing the part of Sterling Morton.
Okay.
My name is Aileen Smith. I'll be playing the part of Charlie Connor.
Okay. Now, is the defendant ready to proceed? And can you please state your appearances on the record?
My name is Rachel Israel. Well, I will be directing Joe Serpico and crossing Charlie Connors.
My name is Mark Huffsmith. I will be directing MJ Henkin in crossing Phoenix Pedante. I will also be delivering the closing argument.
My name is Irma Santiano. I will be delivering the opening statement, directing Sylvester, and crossing Sterling Morton.
Okay, can the witnesses also identify themselves?
I'm Monica Tarabella. I will be portraying the role of Joe Serpico.
I'm Amos Prevett, and I'll be portraying the role of Sylvester.
I'm Joey Steyer, and I'll be portraying the character of MJ Henkin.
Thank you. It's time for opening statements. Is the plaintiff ready to proceed?
Yes, Your Honor.
You may give your opening statement.
Do I have permission to rotate the podium to face the jury?
I don't know if we can do that in this courtroom because we're on film.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, I am presenting to you a case in which the pen is truly mightier than the sword. My client has had his reputation tarnished severely by a harshly written article made by the defendant. This article has caused my client to lose a very valuable scholarship that he earned through hard work and commitment. It has also caused this poor boy to have very horrible mental pain. My client, Phoenix Pedante, comes from a very modest family and is the oldest of six children. This being said, it would be very difficult for Phoenix's family to pay for a college education. Upon realizing this, Phoenix struck out to get a scholarship. And unlike most who attempt to achieve a scholarship, Phoenix succeeded. And this scholarship was a blessing to Phoenix as it paid for nearly all college expenses, including food and lodging, until the reporter, MJ Henkin, jumped to conclusions and accused him of cheating at the mock trial competition on March 23rd, 2012. Phoenix, who was on the mock trial team of Alexander Hamilton High School, was essential in the defeat of the six-year state champions, Dalton Academy. MJ Henkin was also a student at Dalton Academy and had two friends on the Dalton Academy team. And before writing the article, he didn't investigate at all any further than the coach of the Dalton Academy team, who is self-obsessed and a very bad sore loser. In this trial, you will hear from witnesses. Witnesses who were involved somehow in the events leading up to this trial. You also see evidence, including the malicious article which destroyed this poor boy's reputation. There will be elements in this trial that we will dispute. These elements are simple. That there was a false article made about my client, and also that this article is made intentionally or negligently intentionally as a form of revenge against my client for having won the competition, or negligently as they didn't realize what the article would do to him. There are also elements that we do not have to prove. These elements include that there was an article, and that this article did cause the damages done to my client. We must prove the elements we will dispute, we must prove by preponderance of the evidence, meaning we must only tilt the scales of justice a little bit in our favor to win. And when considering this trial, I ask you all to not jump to conclusions like others have, but simply apply the law as you see fit, based on whichever side argues their case better. And if you do this, your decision will be the correct one, I guarantee it.
Thank you. Ms. Santiano, are you prepared to give your opening statement?
Yes, Your Honor.
Then you may do so.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen of the jury. My name is Irma Santiano, and I, along with my co-counsel, Mark Huffsmith and Rachel Israel, will be representing the defense, Dalton Academy. Today, the plaintiff will fail to prove by preponderance of the evidence the six given elements in this case. That the defendant made the statement complained of a third person. The statement was made by writing. The statement was of and concerning the plaintiff. The statement was false in some material respect. Statement was made intentionally or neglectfully. Statement was proximate cause of damages. The plaintiff will have a hard time proving the last three elements. Statement was false in some material respect. Statement was intentionally or neglectfully. And the statement was proximate cause of damages, because they will have to prove that that the statement was written with actual malice. And today I will tell you why. Learn from your mistakes. That's exactly what Mr. Hankin did. The moment MJ Hankin realized that he was wrong, he immediately printed a retraction in the show choir case. If MJ Hankin believed to have had his facts wrong, he would have stepped up to the plate immediately and printed a retraction for the news article of Mr. Perdante cheating during the mock trial competition. But unlike MJ Hankin, Mr. Perdante did not learn from his mistakes. Mr. Perdante accepted an $80,000 scholarship for One Way Foundation that is clearly only for devout Christians, when in fact he is barely even religious, all because of his greed. If he lied about being a true Christian, what, when he signed the morals clause accepting the scholarship that he really wanted, what else might he be lying about? What else might he really want and is willing to lie or even cheat to get? He could want to win the mock trial competition so badly that he cheats and then lies about it. Today, ladies and gentlemen, jury, you will hear from three witnesses. The first witness you will hear from is MJ Hankin. MJ Hankin is currently pursuing a journalism major at Northern University. He is going to testify about how he is positive that Mr. Perdante was showing signs of cheating by sitting with a texting posture and continuously looking behind with a concerned face towards Mr. Morton throughout competition. MJ Hankin will finally testify about his article was false. If his article was false, he will print a retraction with no problem because he has learned from his mistakes in the past. The second witness you will hear from today is Sylvester. Sylvester will be telling you about how his team is the six-time repeating champions of the state tournament and has won nationals three times. He'll finally tell you about how a few weeks ago, his students' emails were hacked, and the hacker was traced back to Alexander Hamilton High School. You will finally hear from Joe Serpico, who is the head security at Northern County Courthouse, working there for 10 years. He will tell you how he saw Mr. Perdante and Mr. Morton using cell phones during competition. He told them to put their cell phones away after Sylvester brought it to attention that no communication of any kind is permitted between students and coaches. We've all made mistakes. There's a classic example of one young man who has learned from his mistakes and another young man who could care less about learning from them. After you have heard all of the evidence here set here before you today, you'll see that the plaintiff has failed to meet the burden of proof and come to a reasonable verdict. MJ Hankin's news article was protected by privilege, was not made with actual malice, and therefore not liable. Thank you.
Thank you. Now it's time for witness testimony. Ms. Southers, are you ready to call your first witness?
Yes, Your Honor. I'd like to call Charlie Connor to the stand.
Very good.
Raise your right hand. Do you swear or affirm that you will testify in accord with the rules of this mock trial tournament?
Yes.
You may proceed.
Could you please state your name for the court?
Charlie Connor.
And can you spell your last name for the record?
C-O-N-N-O-R.
And are you the owner and director of the One Way Trucking Company?
Yes, I am.
Could you tell us what your relationship to the One Way Trucking Company is?
My parents, Robert and Nancy, back in 1952, founded the company.
And did you take over for them?
Yes, I did, back when my father died in 2001.
So when your father passed away, did your mother set up a scholarship fund in his honor?
Yes, she did.
And what was the scholarship fund intended for?
She wanted to help young Christian students who maybe couldn't afford a college education in honor of my father.
So what exactly does the scholarship include?
$80,000 for a full ride scholarship to Northern University for three students.
Well, that's very generous. And what was the cost?
$80,000.
Your Honor, may I approach the bench to show you what has been marked as Exhibit 9?
You may.
post Exhibit 9?
Yes, you may.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you.
I have just handed you what's been marked as Exhibit 9 for identification. Would you identify it, please?
Yes, this is the undergraduate cost calculator for Northern University.
Your Honor, we offer Exhibit Number 9 into evidence at this time.
Does defendant have any objection?
No objections, Your Honor.
Thank you. Then the plaintiff's Exhibit Number 9 will be admitted into evidence. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Honor. Mrs. Connor, according to Exhibit 9, what was the value of the scholarship that had been awarded to Phoenix Predante?
For two semesters per year for 4 years, the student will be granted $80,000.
Okay, moving on, Mrs. Connor. How long has your company been sponsoring the scholarship program?
12 years.
And can you tell us how high school students can apply for the scholarship?
The applicants must write an essay based on their morality. Then we closely read over the essays and give permission for who is worthy of the scholarship.
And did Phoenix Predante write a good essay regarding morality?
Yes, he did.
Your Honor, may I approach the bench to show you what has been marked as Exhibit Number 2?
You may. Thank you.
May I approach the witness with proposed Exhibit 2?
Yes.
Thank you.
I've just handed you what has been marked as Exhibit 2 for identification. Would you identify it, please?
This is the scholarship award letter given to Phoenix Predante.
Your Honor, we offer Exhibit Number 2 into evidence at this time.
Does defendant have any objections?
No objection, Your Honor.
Then the plaintiff's Exhibit Number 2 will be admitted into evidence.
Thank you. Mrs. Connor, could you read Exhibit 2, Paragraph 2 out loud for us, please?
Yes. I must tell you that we were most impressed by the essay that you submitted as part of your application. It is refreshing to find an articulate, honest, hardworking Christian youth such as yourself. In this day and age, it is rare to find people like you who know right from wrong and who are not afraid to stand up for their beliefs.
So according to that letter, was your company very impressed by the essay Phoenix wrote?
Yes, very.
Now, Mrs. Connor, is it just the essay that you look at when selecting your scholarship winners?
No, we closely look at the students with rigid and really high standards.
And Phoenix Predante met all these requirements?
Yes, he did.
Now, did Phoenix Predante recently receive a letter in the mail from your company stating that his scholarship had been revoked?
Yes.
Mrs. Connor, could you please tell the court why your company took away his approximately $80,000 scholarship?
It came to our company's attention that Phoenix Predante was accused of cheating at his mock trial tournament. Sorry.
Where did you see that?
Online, the Dalton Academy newsletter.
Your Honor, may I approach the bench to show you what's been marked as Exhibit 1?
Of course. Thank you.
May I also approach the witness with proposed Exhibit 1?
Yes, you may.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I have just handed you what has been marked as Exhibit 1 for identification. Would you identify it, please?
Yes, this is the article that I read.
Your Honor, we offer Exhibit Number 1 into evidence at this time.
Does defendant have any objections?
No objections, Your Honor.
Then plaintiff's Exhibit Number 1 will be admitted into evidence. Thank you.
Mrs. Connor, could you read the title of the article, please?
Verdict. Cheaters really do win sometimes.
And in this article, who do you feel they're accusing of cheating?
I feel they're accusing cheating Phoenix Predante and his coach.
And did you revoke Phoenix Predante's scholarship based on this article, or did you further investigate the matter?
No, the article was sufficient.
Your Honor, may I approach the bench to show you what's been marked as Exhibit 4?
Yes. Thank you.
Approach the witness with proposed Exhibit 4?
Yes, you may.
I have just handed you what's been marked as Exhibit 4 for identification. Would you identify it, please?
This is the scholarship revocation letter given to Phoenix Predante.
Your Honor, we offer Exhibit Number 4 into evidence at this time.
Does defendant have any objections?
No objections, Your Honor.
Then the plaintiff's Exhibit Number 4 will be admitted into evidence.
Thank you, Your Honor. Mrs. Connor, could you read paragraph 1 and the first line of paragraph 2 for us?
Yes. Please consider this as your formal notice that your scholarship from One Way Scholarship Foundation is being revoked, effectively immediately. It has come to the attention of the foundation that you've been accused of cheating in a high school trial event. A recent article in the Dalton Wolverine School e-paper outlined how you and your coach had cheated to win the state mock trial championship this year.
And is this the letter you sent Phoenix revoking his scholarship?
Yes.
Did you send this letter because of the article you read that was published by Dalton Academy?
We did.
Thank you. No further questions, Your Honor.
Thank you. Is there a cross-examination for this witness?
Yes, Your Honor.
Good afternoon, Ms. Connor.
Good afternoon.
In 2001, did your mother set up the One-Way Scholarship Foundation in your father's honor?
Yes, she did.
Was it her vision to have the foundation award 3 full scholarships?
Yes.
Were those scholarships $80,000 per scholarship for 4 years?
Yes.
Did your father's life insurance initially fund the foundation?
Yes.
Does your father's life insurance continue to fully fund the $240,000 for the 3 scholarships today?
Somewhat, but we also get some donations.
Yes or no question,
please? No.
Thank you. Did the One-Way Trucking Company have to use donations to fund the scholarships?
Can you restate the question, please?
Did the One-Way Trucking Company then have to use donations to fund the scholarships?
Yes.
Is it true that in recent years, One-Way Trucking has taken a serious financial hit because of rising costs of fuel?
Somewhat.
In recent years, have family members been personally asked to donate to the foundation?
Yes.
Was that so the foundation could fully fund the scholarships?
Yes.
If family does not continue to donate to fully fund the scholarships, will the 3 scholarships continue?
I cannot answer that question. I'm sorry.
Have family members signed commitment contracts guarantee their donations?
Yes.
They have. Then does the... Does the foundation have $240,000 to fund 3 scholarships next year?
Yes.
Then why were family members asked to donate?
So that we could have the money to give to the students.
Mrs. Connors, you didn't state in your witness statement that family members had been donating to the scholarship so that the scholarships were able to be fully funded in next year. I said the question wrong. I'm sorry.
Okay.
That was my fault. I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Ms. Connors, didn't you state in your witness statement that family members had to donate so that the scholarships would be able to be fully funded in recent years?
Yes.
Objection, relevance?
I'm just trying to prove that Phoenix Perdante scholarship might have been taken away for another reason other than the article.
Objection overruled.
Thank you, Your Honor.
You're welcome.
The scholarship still has... scholarship still has money in it for next year, then why are you still asking for donations?
So that we can donate so the students can go to college.
No further questioning, Your Honor.
Thank you. Ms. Southers, do you have any redirect?
No, Your Honor.
Okay. Then, Ms. Connor, you can step down. Mr. Freeman, you can call the next witness.
Defense would like to call Sterling Morton to the stand.
Right hand, please. Do you swear and affirm that you will testify in accord with the rules of the mock trial tournament?
Yes, I do.
please state your name for the court, sir?
Sterling Morton.
And could you spell your last name for the record?
M-O-R-T-O-N.
Are you currently employed, sir?
Yes, I am.
And where are you employed?
Alexander Hamilton High School.
What do you do there?
I am the civics teacher and AP ethics teacher.
Is there anything else that you do at the school?
I am the coach of the Alexander Hamilton mock trial team.
And what qualifies you to do your job?
I received my master's degree in educational management with a minor's degree in philosophy.
Was Phoenix Perdante ever a participant on your mock trial team?
Yes, he was.
And what kind of participant was he?
His first few years, he was a very weak and shy performer.
And did you attempt to help Phoenix to improve his abilities?
Yes, I did.
And do you feel he was prepared on the morning of March 23rd, 2012?
Yes, I do.
Were there any problems that arose that morning at competition?
Sadly, yes. His allergies started to act up.
And was there anything you did as a coach to alleviate his discomfort?
Yes. I placed a box of tissues on the stand next to him.
And is there anything else you did for him?
Yes. I texted him to see how he was feeling.
And is there anything in the rules that mentions... Is there anything in the rules to mock trial that prevents a coach from texting a student on how they're feeling?
No, there's not.
Nothing further, Your Honor.
Thank you. Ms. Santiano, do you have any cross-examination?
Yes, Your Honor. You are aware that once trial begins, no coaching is permitted, correct?
Correct.
You are aware that the rules are also stipulated to coaches and attorneys as well as not to engage in communication until after the closing statement, right?
Defendant-related conversation.
Did you send Mr. Perdante a text message during competition?
Yes, I did.
And isn't that a form of communication?
Yes.
So you claim that you know the rules, and yet you were texting him, right?
Yes.
May we see the messages?
No, they are not here.
Because why?
They have been deleted.
You deleted the text messages, right?
Yes.
So you deleted the proof that we needed today to solve this problem?
Yes.
And you didn't think at the time that we needed the text messages?
No, I did not.
Was there something that you were hiding, that you had to delete the messages?
No.
So at the time, you didn't think that there was something important that could have helped us solve the case?
Correct.
So we will never know the truth because you deleted them?
Correct.
So moving on to Mr. Perdante's performance. Ms. Perdante and you have developed an alternative closing arguments for each party depending on the theory of the opposing team used, right?
Correct.
And wasn't Mr. Perdante a very weak performer before?
Yes, but we fixed that.
And were you not concerned with which closing he would choose?
No.
If he was a weak performer, I would be concerned.
We worked with him this year to make him better.
Yes or no, please. Would you be concerned?
No.
No further questions, Your Honor.
Mr. Freeman, do you have any redirects?
Yes, I do, Your Honor.
Okay, please.
You said you texted Phoenix about his health, and would that count as a tournament-related conversation?
No, it would not.
And what does the rule preventing conversation between a coach and a student, what does that say?
It says you may not talk about tournament-related conversation.
Nothing further, Your Honor.
Thank you. Ms. Santiano, do you have any recross?
No, Your Honor.
Thank you. Mr. Morton, you can step down. Ms. Bynum, you may call your next witness.
Your Honor, I'd like to call to the stand Phoenix Perdante.
Okay.
Raise your right hand. Do you swear or affirm that you will testify in accord with the rules of this mock trial tournament?
I do.
Could you please state your name and spell your last name for the record?
Phoenix Perdante, P-E-R-D-A-N-T-E.
Phoenix, what school do you attend?
Alexander Hamilton High School.
Do you have any siblings?
Yes, I do. I have 5 of them.
Is it hard for them to get scholarships?
No, they're pretty good athletes, so they'll easily obtain scholarships.
How important are scholarships to your family?
Very, because of our financial situation.
What is your financial situation like?
We're at the wealthiest family, so it's kind of hard to pay for college for 6 children.
Have you applied for any scholarships?
Yes, I did. I applied to the One Way Scholarship Foundation.
What is the scholarship for?
It is for people interested in trucking.
Now that you have testified, you applied for the scholarship. What was the outcome?
I received the scholarship.
What was the Skynet scholarship worth to you financially?
About $80,000.
What is your estimate based on?
It is based off of $10,000 per semester for 2 semesters for 4 years.
What interested you in this scholarship?
My grandfather was a trucker, and he was a great man, and he influenced me to go into trucking.
Do you have the scholarship money today?
Unfortunately, no, I do not.
Why not?
Because it was taken from me by an arrogant, angry coach and a non-professional reporter.
What did they do?
They printed a lie about me.
When did they print this lie?
Could you repeat the question for me?
When did they print the lie?
They printed it after the mock trial championship.
Mock trial. Tell me about your past with mock trial.
I was in mock trial for 3 years. The first couple of years, I wasn't very good. I had bad memorization skills, and I normally got stuck with a witness that didn't really have much to say.
Did you get any better?
Yes, I did, with the help of my coach.
How did he help you?
He helped me with memorization skills and worked with me over time, and he had great faith in me that I would do great things.
Great things? Like what?
Winning the state championship.
I would like to ask you a couple questions about the competition, okay?
All right.
How were you feeling that day?
I was feeling very sick.
What symptoms did you have?
I had a runny nose and watery eyes.
Did your coach do anything relating to your sickness?
Yes, he put a box of Kleenex next to me.
Phoenix, during the trial competition, did you have your phone with you?
Yes, I did.
Did you receive any text messages during the comp?
Yes, just one.
Do you know who sent it?
Yes, my coach.
Did you read the text message?
No, I did not.
What was your reaction when you received the text message?
I was a little angry. Here I was in the heat of battle, and then I receive a text from my coach. I was just really annoyed.
What did you do?
I shot him a dirty look.
Was the competition close?
Yes, it was very close.
What helped you guys win?
My closing argument.
Phoenix, are you aware of an article written about you in mock trial?
Yes, I am.
What is the essence of this article?
It claims that I cheated during the mock trial tournament.
Do you know who wrote the article?
Yes, I do. MJ Hankin.
Did you see the article when it was written?
No, I did not.
After you found out about the article written, did you contact MJ Hankin?
Yes, I did.
What form of contact did you make?
I sent her an email.
Your Honor, may I approach the witness to show him Exhibit 6?
Yes, you may. Thank you.
Yes. Phoenix, I have handed you what has been marked as Exhibit 6. What is it?
It is a copy of the email that I sent to MJ Hankin.
Your Honor, if there are no objections by the defense, I would move to admit Exhibit 6 into evidence.
Mr. Huffsmith, do you have any objections?
No, Your Honor.
Then plaintiff's Exhibit 6 will be admitted.
Thank you. Now, sir, I'd like to ask you some questions about the email.
Okay.
What is the purpose of this email?
To demand a retraction.
Was a retraction ever printed?
No, unfortunately not.
Were there any other email reasons you sent the email?
Yes, I wanted to set the record straight.
Anything else?
And I denied cheating.
Did you ever get an apology?
No, I did not.
Phoenix, what were your feelings about the article?
I was extremely hurt. I didn't die or anything, but I just wanted to go into a deep sleep and just never wake up because I was just so hurt from this.
How severe were these feelings?
They were unbelievably severe.
Why did you bring this lawsuit today, Phoenix?
To show the world that I did not cheat and that I would like a retraction and an apology.
Nothing further, Your Honor.
Thank you. Mr. Huffsmith, do you have any cross-examination for this witness?
Yes, Your Honor. You needed the One Way Scholarship Foundation, correct?
Correct.
And you were aware of the requirements attached to the scholarship, correct?
Yes, I was.
However, you were aware that you didn't quite measure up to the standards set by the Morals Clause, correct?
Not quite, yes.
MJ Hankin asked you to produce phone records, correct?
Correct.
And you didn't have phone records to produce, right?
Correct.
During the trial, you received a text from Sterling Morton, correct?
Yes.
And you had your cell phone out during the trial, correct?
Yes.
And you were aware that there were signs around the courtroom stating all cell phones should be turned off, correct?
Yes.
But you had it out anyways.
I did.
Thank you, Your Honor. No further questions.
Thank you. Ms. Bynum, do you have any redirect?
Yes, I do. Phoenix, do you believe you behave as a good Christian?
Yes, of course.
Did you read the text message during mock trial 2012?
No, I did not.
Nothing further.
Thank you. And Mr. Huffsmith, do you have any recross?
No, Your Honor.
Mr. Perdante, you may step down. We're ready to start the defendant's case. Mr. Huffsmith, you may call your first witness.
Your Honor, at this time, the defense calls MJ Hankin to the stand.
Please raise your right hand. Do you swear or affirm that you will testify in accord with the rules of this mock trial tournament?
I do.
For the record, will you state your name?
Yes, my name's MJ Hankin.
And what is your role in this case?
Well, last year I attended the mock trial competition and I wrote an article about it.
All right. In high school, did you take any classes pertaining to reporting?
Yes, I was the deputy editor of the Wolverine newspaper, and I took a two-hour class with our teacher, Mr. Morrow. He was a great guy.
Did Mr. Morrow teach you a certain technique to use when reporting?
Yes, he always taught us to go straight for the facts. It's all about the facts. Forget about all the fluffy stuff.
All right, and did you attend the mock trial tournament on March 23rd, 2012?
I did.
During the competition, what did you observe of the team Alexander Hamilton High School?
Well, it was a pretty heated tournament. They were rival schools. It was a rival school. And there was a person on the team that I later found out was Phoenix Perdante, and it appeared that he was texting on his phone during the trial.
Right. And did you know Phoenix before the competition?
No, I just knew of him, but I didn't know him personally.
And what exactly did you observe of Phoenix during the trial?
Well, he was looking down his lap a lot, and he looked back towards his coach, Mr. Morton, a few times during the trial.
Oh, what did you observe of Sterling Morton during the trial?
Well, he was slouched over in his seat, and it appeared that he was texting on his phone as well, and he would look up at Phoenix when he would turn his back and look at him.
Moving on now, what did Sylvester say to you after the trial was over?
Well, I was waiting for quotes for the article, and he seemed very upset, and he said that their emails got hacked and that they were cheated out of their win.
All right. And have you received information from Sylvester before?
Yes, I have.
And how did that go?
Well, he exaggerated a little bit on it, and I didn't get a second look at it, and I printed the article, and there was some false information in it.
All right, but what did you learn from that experience?
I learned that you have to get more than one source, and you have to check your facts more than once, and I had to print a retraction.
So when printing this article, how is it any different from the last one?
I had more than one source, and I did check my facts, and I learned my lesson.
And are you against printing retraction?
No, not at all.
Thank you, Your Honor. No further questions.
Thank you. Mr. Freeman, do you have any cross-examination for this witness?
Yes, I do. Mr. Hankin, would you say that you were an unbiased reporter?
An unbiased reporter, yes.
And you are the author of the article, Verdict, Cheaters Really Do Win Sometimes, correct?
Yes.
And you picked that title, correct?
I wrote the article, yes.
That's not what I asked you. You picked the title, correct?
I suppose, yes.
You interviewed Sylvester, correct?
I did.
For that article?
Yes.
And you had had no other sources, correct?
I had a few other sources, yes.
Who were they?
Myself was one of them, and the other ones are confidential.
Okay. So, using you and your and the coach, Sylvester, as sources, you speculated that my client was cheating during the mock trial, correct?
I had a few other sources, and I did check my sources, and they matched out to what Mr. Sylvester said.
But you have no hard evidence that my client cheated, correct?
There's no phone records, no.
So you're it is pure speculation that my client cheated during the mock trial, correct?
It's not speculation. I saw it, and I got my facts straight this time.
You're telling me that you saw my client pick up his phone and text the coach back?
No, but I did see their appearance of it.
All you saw was the appearance?
Yes.
So you don't know that my client was texting, correct?
Not officially, but it appeared that way.
And don't reporters write only the truth?
We do.
And if you're going to report the truth, you must have facts, correct?
You must.
So if you don't have facts, then, and you printed the article, you are not reporting the truth, correct?
We had enough evidence to support the truth, and we did print an article, and it was true.
But you had no hard facts to print this article, correct?
You don't always need hard facts. Sometimes, if you have enough evidence that stands up against it, you can use that to back it up.
But don't you need hard facts to have the truth?
Not always.
Your Honor, asked and answered.
Okay.
What is your response to that objection? Okay, so objection sustained.
Yeah. Thank you, Your Honor.
Okay. So if you didn't have the evidence that Phoenix was cheating, then how do you know that he was cheating?
We had enough evidence. It might not have been factual evidence, but we did have it.
Would you say that asking how someone is feeling is cheating?
I don't know what you mean.
If Sterling Morton texted Phoenix asking how he was feeling, would you say that was cheating?
There wasn't supposed to be any communication going on during the trial, so yes.
In earlier testimony, Sterling Morton stated that in the rules, only trial-related conversation was against the rules, correct?
Well, there's really no way you can tell if there was trial-related going on or not, but Phoenix did look back at him a few times, so obviously they were conversating more than just the cell phone.
If there's no way you can tell that it was trial-related conversation, how can you say that my client was a cheater?
Well, due to all the evidence that was presented and the talk with Sylvester, we can conclude that your client, Phoenix, did cheat.
You said earlier also that you printed a false article on the Dalton Swing Choir, correct?
I did.
And who was your source for that?
Sylvester.
So you used, for this article, you used a source who has been proven to have false information, correct?
I used more than just him, but yes, and I did learn my lesson.
Nothing further, Your Honor.
Okay. Mr. Huffsmith, do you have any redirects?
Yes, Your Honor. MJ Hankin, are you biased?
No.
No further questions, Your Honor.
Mr. Freeman, do you have any recross?
No, Your Honor.
Thank you. Mr. Hankin, you can step down.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Ms. Santiano, you may call your next witness.
Defense call Sylvester to the stand.
Raise your right hand. Do you swear or affirm that you will testify in accord with the rules of this mock trial tournament?
I do.
State your name for the record.
Sylvester.
What is your occupation?
I'm the faculty sponsor of the mock trial team at Dalton Academy.
How did you decide you wanted to coach at Dalton Academy?
Well, I was offered a lot of jobs for coaching, but one of the pros for coaching at Dalton Academy would have been the fact that I would have gotten a personal assistant.
What accomplishments in relation to Mark Trout can you add to your resume?
Well, I've won state champions 6 times in a row now, and I've also gone to nationals and won 3 times.
Were you the coach of Dalton Academy's mock trial team on March 23rd?
I was.
Your Honor, at this time, I would like to enter Sylvester as an expert witness in the field of mock trial.
Is there any objection?
Objection?
And what is the reason for your objection?
Just because he won doesn't mean he's an expert.
And what is your response to that?
Your Honor, Sylvester shows level of expertise because he's a 6-time repeating champion of state tournament. Is the only sponsor to ever win superior win nationals 3 times. He was recruited by Dalton Academy, a prestigious school, to coach Mark Trial there, and is currently in the process of writing a book about Mark Trial.
Motion to qualify Mr. Vester as an expert witness is denied.
And I have an objection, unfair extrapolation.
Can you show me in the factual scenario where there is any kind of expertise outlined that you would use to qualify this witness as an expert witness?
He's a 6-time repeating champion. Is the only sponsor to ever win superior in nationals 3 times. I think that makes him qualified to be an expert.
I think how I'm going to rule is her motion to qualify him is denied. Okay?
Okay, thank you, Your Honor.
You're welcome.
On March 23rd, where were you?
I was at the mock trial state tournament.
Did you notice anything unusual during competition?
Actually, I did. I noticed that when I looked at Sterling Morton, he seemed to be looking down in his lap a lot. It was kind of weird to me. I thought maybe they were taking notes or something. Then I looked at Phoenix during the recess, and I actually saw that he had his phone out that appeared to be using it. And then I looked back at Morton, and it seemed to be something was going on there.
Did you report it to anyone?
I did. I reported it to the security guard, Joe Serpico.
What did Joe tell him?
Joe told everybody that you need to have your phones off in the courtroom. And not only that, there were also signs posted around the court that phones need to be turned off.
Do you think that communication between Mr. Perante and Morton affected the outcome of the competition?
I think it had a great outcome. I mean, something like that, if they had to, it could have changed how it happened.
Now let's take it back to a couple of weeks prior to competition. What happened to your students' emails?
I noticed that, well, first of all, me and my students have an email, so we know what's going on. And we noticed that it has been hacked, and I had my kid come in. He's a real computer geek. He looked up, and he noticed that it went back to Alexander Hamilton High School.
Did it cause you any concern?
It caused me great concern. The fact that they're trying to view in on our details comes to me as they might be willing to cheat for something like state finals.
Can you think of any situation where any coach would send a text message to any student during competition?
We're in state finals. You're not going to throw that away over a text.
Thank you, Honor. No further questions.
Ms. Bynum, do you have any cross-examination of this witness?
Yes, I
do. So you are the 6-time defending champion. You are, correct?
And 3-time nationals.
You attribute the wins from mock trial to your coaching, correct?
I do believe that I am a preferably good coach.
In your opinion, no team could win without cheating, right?
Yes.
Especially Alexander, correct?
I've seen how they performed before.
During the trial, you thought you were in the lead, correct?
I did.
In fact, you claim you were winning by a landslide, right?
Yeah, the way my team was performing, I did believe that we were winning.
But the score sheets showed a much closer race, didn't they?
Well, I obviously couldn't see the score sheets during the time, but from what I thought, I did think that we were winning.
Okay. Close enough, they were in a close enough race to say that winning by a landslide is an exaggeration, correct?
Like I said, I don't know how the jury may have judged that. But from my preference and the coaching preference and how my team was performing, I did think we were winning.
But that is an exaggeration. graduation, correct?
If you want to take it like that.
When you found out that Alexander had beat Dalton, you assumed they had cheated, correct?
Yes, from what I saw and what I was based on, I did think that they were cheating.
You thought this because you were baffled that someone had actually beat Dalton, correct?
I was surprised that we lost, but from the things that I saw, it kind of seemed that they were cheating.
Phoenix was visibly sick that day, wasn't he?
I guess so.
And Sterling put a box of tissues next to Phoenix, didn't he?
Yes.
You said you saw texting occurring, correct?
I said I saw their phones out that seemed to be being used.
You assume Phoenix was texting Sterling, correct?
Yes.
But you could not see what was on those text messages, correct?
No one can. They have been deleted.
During the trial, you could not see what was on those text messages, correct?
No.
Okay. With being such a great coach, you are familiar with the rules of mock trial, aren't you?
I am.
You realize that there is no rule that says a coach may not attempt to communicate with a student during the competition, correct?
The rule was that there's no coaching or talking about the trial during the tournament, but not only that, there were also signs posted around the courtroom saying the cell phones need to be turned off.
Okay. If a student is under the weather, you would probably talk to them, wouldn't you?
Yeah, maybe after the trial on a break or something. I wouldn't want to disrupt something, though, if it's state finals.
If their nose is running down their face, or...
Objection, Your Honor, relevance?
Response.
I'm just trying to see his opinion on this.
Objection overruled.
Thank you, Your Honor.
I do believe that there was a box of tissues there for him if something like that happened.
This rule, 9A, you would know it, it only prohibits tournament-related conversation, correct?
The rule does prohibit tournament, so obviously you can't talk about the tournament. But beside the mock trial rule, there's also courtroom signs that say no phones.
That's all I asked. When you claim to have seen cheating, you never went to the proper authorities like you're supposed to, correct?
Correct. I only went to Joseph Rico.
In fact, you wait until after the tournament when you are supposed to tell them right then and there, immediately.
Actually, I went to Joe Serpico during it.
That's unfair extrapolation.
There's been no objection.
Oh. Okay. being such a great coach, you know that the bailiff isn't the proper authorities, correct?
Correct. After, I just didn't want to make a disruption during the whole thing.
After the tournament, you told a reporter, MJ Hankin, your assumption on the texting situation, didn't you?
Correct.
Not only that, but you told the reporter a lie, didn't you?
No, I believe that I was cheated out. I mean, I saw what I saw, and I don't think I should let something like that fly. And this being my almost seventh win, possibly going back to nationals, I do believe that this was a big cause of my problem, and I do believe that we were cheated out of our win.
Where were you sitting in the courtroom?
The third. There's a diagram also about that, but in the third row.
And you're telling me you could see a phone in Phoenix's lap?
Yes.
Okay.
I could also see it in Sterling Morton's.
You lied about Phoenix Perdante in that article, didn't you?
In what article?
In the article.
No, what I saw is what I believe to be true.
Which is an assumption.
It's just what I saw, and that's what I thought was true.
This isn't the first time you've tried to put rumors in that newspaper about Alexander Hamilton High School, is it?
Are you referring to the...
I'm referring to the choir and...
Objection, Your Honor, relevance. I don't see what the show choir case has to do with this.
This is possibly the third time he's tried to print false information about Alexander Hamilton High School.
Objection overruled.
Thank you, Your Honor.
So
So this isn't the first time you've tried to print false information about Alexander Hamilton High School, is it?
I don't believe I was purposely trying to print false things.
This is the third time you've tried to print something about Alexander Hamilton High School, is it not?
I just talked to the reporter and that was it. I never made them print something. It's just what I said to them. If they want to take that a different way, I guess they could.
In regards to the situation about hacking computers, you tried to print something about Alexander Hamilton High School, and the reporter said that she couldn't even confirm it, correct?
What had happened was that my computer was hacked, but I never tried to force them to write a report on that. I just have told them that, and I never made them report that or anything.
You tried, though, correct?
I told him the story. That was all.
Your Honor, may I refresh the witness's memory as to what he said in his witness statement?
Is there an objection regarding the foundation?
No objection, Your Honor.
Okay.
Would you like me to show you?
Thank you.
Mr. Vester, can you read what you said right here out loud?
He said he couldn't, she said he couldn't confirm it.
Just go.
So she didn't use it. I knew it was true. She doubted me.
Yes.
Thank you.
Now, does that say that you tried to put this false information about Alexander Hamilton High School, once again, into an article?
I told the reporter what the article was about, and they said that I didn't have enough information, and obviously I told them the article, but I never tried to force them, make them, try to write my own article or anything.
All I'm asking is if you tried.
All I did was tell them what I told them. That was it.
You were going to blame Alexander Hamilton High School once again.
For the hacking?
Yes.
Yes, that's because someone traced it back to them.
Who?
The kid that came who's a real computer geek.
If you think you're going to ruin a school's reputation, don't you think you should use a professional to trace a hacked computer?
No. That's who I had, and that's who did it.
So you wouldn't use a professional to ruin somebody's reputation. You're just going to go off what a child says.
I don't have a professional computer hacker, so I guess I couldn't use one.
You could hire one, correct?
I guess, if that's possible.
All your allegations are based on assumptions that didn't take place until after the competition, correct?
Are you talking about how I thought there was cheating?
Yes.
Yeah, I saw that during the competition. That's what I thought happened.
And you didn't say anything until after, correct?
I said something during the competition to Joe Serpico.
And everything that you have claimed that you have seen are all assumptions, correct?
From what I saw, yes.
They aren't based on cold, hard fact.
I saw the phones out, and that's what I saw.
Nothing further, Your Honor.
Thank you. Ms. Santiano, do you have any redirect?
Yes, Your Honor.
Did you want to ruin Alexander's reputation?
No. I was kind of more focused on my team.
When you saw Mr. Perante and Mr. Morton using their cell phones, why didn't you file a complaint?
I filed one to Joe Serpico, but I didn't want to make a big disruption. And like I said earlier, I kind of figured that we were already winning.
Thank you, Your Honor. No further questions.
Ms. Bynum, do you have any recross?
Actually, I do. Thank you.
You're welcome.
So after the competition, why didn't you tell the proper authorities then?
I told Joe Serpico.
Joe Serpico, the bailiff, is not the proper authority.
Yes, I know.
Nothing further.
Thank you. Anything further?
No, Your Honor.
Okay. Mr. Vester, you can step down.
Thank you, Judge.
Ms. Israel, you may call your next witness.
I would like to call Joe Serpico up to the witness stand.
You swear or affirm that you will testify in accord with the rules of this mock trial tournament?
I do. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Can you please state your name for the record?
Joe Serpico.
Where do you live?
I live at 3691 Marlin Hall Road.
What is your occupation?
I'm a head of security at Northern Courthouse.
What kind of life experience and training have you had prior to this job?
I was in the Army Reserves, and I went to college for criminal justice and architectural landscaping.
How long have you worked at the courthouse?
10 years.
Have you always had the job you have now?
No, I had to work my way up through the levels.
What different responsibilities do you have as head of security?
It is my job to take care of contraband such as scissors, knives, things that people bring into the courthouse. I also formulate and implicate security plans, and I also keep the peace and play bailiff in the courtrooms when court's in session and not in session.
What is one of the major issues at the courthouse?
Cell phones.
Does the courtroom do anything about this issue?
There are signs everywhere that state cell phones must be off.
Do you remember what two schools were competing on March 24th?
Dalton Academy and Alexander Hamilton High School.
Did you recognize Perdante before the competition?
I didn't.
Do you remember Coach Vester?
I do.
Why do you remember him?
He seemed like he was a very intense judge, always watching the competition.
Do you remember Coach Morton?
I do.
What stuck out about him to you?
He didn't really seem as focused as Vester did. He seemed more like he was staring at his lap throughout the competition.
Did Coach Vester ever approach you during the trial about texting?
He did.
What did you learn?
I learned that he had saw Phoenix Perdante and Sterling Morton had their cell phones out.
What happened after the competition?
Coach Vester asked me to... or came to me with a formal complaint that he had seen cheating.
No further questions, Your Honor.
Ms. Southers, do you have any cross-examination of this witness?
Yes, Your Honor. Mrs. Serpico, what is your job here at the courthouse?
I'm head of security.
And as the head of security, you must see a lot of interesting things take place.
Correct? I do.
And I'm sure you see lawyers using their cell phones quite frequently, right?
Unfortunately, yes.
And people use them in the courtroom to look at their calendar, check emails, and look up information often, correct?
People are not allowed to, only the lawyers. It's something that we've had to let happen because of newer day technology.
So lawyers use them frequently, correct?
For checking emails and such.
And you don't even make a big deal out of someone having a cell phone, do you?
If it goes off and it's disturbing the courtroom, I have to. It's my job.
And isn't it true that judges don't really mind if people use them as long as the ringers don't distract anyone, correct?
In a formal courtroom.
But the judges don't mind if they use them, correct?
I suppose.
And would you say you are very in tune with what's going on with cell phones in your courtroom because they're so frequently used?
I am.
Now, do you remember the mock trial tournament recently between Dalton Academy and Alexander Hamilton High?
Yes.
Could you point or tell us approximately where you were sitting during the trial?
No, I can't.
Your Honor, may I approach the bench to show you what was marked as Exhibit 7 and 8 A and B?
Yes. Thank you.
May I approach the witness with proposed Exhibit 7 and 8 A and B?
You may.
Thank you.
And
this one? Thank you.
I've just handed you what's been marked as Exhibit 7 and 8 A and B. Could you identify them, please?
Where they are?
Could you tell them? Could you tell us what they are?
They're pictures of the courtroom and where I was standing, and a drawn-in illustration that I made.
Your Honor, we offer Exhibit 7 and 8 A and B into evidence at this time.
Ms. Israel, do you have any objection to their being admitted?
No objections, Your Honor.
Then at this time, I would accept into evidence Plaintiff's Exhibits 7 and 8 A and B. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Honor. Now, looking at these exhibits, wouldn't you say from where Coach Vester is sitting, his view of Phoenix Pradante is obstructed by the high back benches and the courtroom's railing?
I'd say it's possible.
And isn't it fair to say that your angle of Phoenix Pradante and Mr. Morton is better than Coach Vester's?
Slightly.
Now, from your angle, could you see if Phoenix Pradante had a cell phone?
I don't believe so.
You don't believe he had a cell phone?
I only saw him looking down in his lap.
And as you said earlier, lawyers and people use their cell phones all the time in the courtroom, and judges have no problem with that, so there was no cause for alarm, correct?
In a formal courtroom, yes, but not while court's continuing through.
But there was no cause for alarm that he was looking down in his lap, correct?
I suppose.
And from your statement, Phoenix Pradante's phone, he looked down at his lap?
Yes.
Right? And from your angle, you couldn't possibly tell if a cell phone was on, right?
No.
And in your statement, you said that Phoenix Pradante looked down?
Yes.
Also in your statement, you said that Phoenix Pradante appeared to look at his phone, but you never said you saw him touch or text with his fingers. Isn't that correct?
Correct.
In fact, isn't it true that you never saw Phoenix communicate with his cell phone at all during the mock trial competition?
That is true.
Yeah, he is accused of cheating, and you, the head of security, never saw him touch or text on his phone, which you stated earlier is definitely something you're very in tune with, correct?
Correct.
Now, to your knowledge, Mrs. Serpico, don't you have to touch a cell phone in order to open and read a text message?
Yes.
Yet you never actually saw him touch it, don't you? Did you?
I didn't actually see him touch it.
And you never actually did verify in any way that Phoenix Pradante and his coach may have been texting each other, right?
It's not my job.
It's not your job to verify the cell phones in the courtroom?
I'm there as a supervisor, but when coming to mock trial rules, such as coaching communication, I have no knowledge of that. I simply told everyone to put their cell phones away when Vester came up to me and reported a complaint.
And you said Vester complained to you about Coach Morton, right?
He complained about the cell phone usage.
And in fact, Vester was acting a little irrational, wasn't he?
He seemed very upset.
And he wanted you to remove the entire Alexander Hamilton High mock trial team from the courthouse, but you didn't do that, did you?
No, I just thought he was acting out of emotion.
You figured that Vester was just upset they lost, right?
Ms. Israel, do you have any redirect?
Yes, I do, Your Honor.
Okay.
Were you given a set of mock trial rules?
No, I was not.
Is it your responsibility to enforce mock trial rules?
No.
Thank you. No further questions.
Thank you. Ms. Serpico, you can step down.
Thank you.
Now it's time for closing arguments. On behalf of plaintiff, Ms. Bynum, are you prepared?
Yes, I am.
Then you may proceed.
In this case, the pen was truly mightier than the sword. It killed Phoenix's reputation, opportunity, and mental health. With no verification, no factual evidence, an article that ruined Phoenix's life was printed. Not only is this a tragedy, but there's two legal issues in this case. The content of the article, verdict, cheaters really do win sometimes, and whether or not it was intentional or negligent. The article was based on an assumption, no evidence. I asked the jury to ask themselves, what evidence is against Phoenix Pradante? There's none. Guessing and assuming is not an excuse to defame someone's reputation. This article defamed not only Phoenix, but the Alexander Hamilton mock trial team, along with the school. Dalton acted as if they were superior over Alexander. Not good enough.
After all the hard work, they look back on what is supposed to be a wonderful memory, and they look at it as a nightmare. The feeling of winning after hard work was stolen from them with one sloppy article. Sal tried to have a reporter blame Alexander Hamilton High School in an article for Dalton's email accounts being hacked. Not the first try to defame Alexander Hamilton High School. Phoenix's mental health was even compromised because of all this. He was devastated. His moment to shine was completely torn apart. The article was the main reason for his scholarship to be taken away from him. This is another accomplishment that's ruined because some adult mock trial coach was mad because he lost. The final issue is whether or not MJ printed this article in negligence or intentionally. The article is not based on evidence. It is based off of speculation. Sal never told the proper authorities. The reporter never interviewed the bailiff. That's negligence. The preponderance of the evidence shows that Phoenix did not cheat. But Sal and MJ Hinken committed the tort of defamation. You can't unring a bell that's already been rung, but you can't silence it. Your verdict will prevent more innocent mock trial teams from being victimized from Dalton Academy. I ask the jury to use their pen to rewrite the wrong done and return the verdict in the plaintiff's favor. Nothing further, Your Honor.
Thank you. Mr. Huffsmith, are you prepared to give your closing argument?
Yes, Your Honor.
Then you may proceed.
Thank you. On behalf of myself and my co-counsel, I'd like to thank you for being attentive and listening objectively to all the information presented to you today. Once again, my name is Mark Huffsmith. In life, people make mistakes, but whether you learn from them or not, that is the true question. MJ Hinken has made a mistake in the past. He's owned up to it, and he's printed a retraction. That is not the case with the article in question today. It is a solid, truthful article. There has been no mistake made here. Phoenix Perdante, on the other hand, has not learned from his mistakes. Phoenix Perdante cheated his way into the One Way Scholarship Foundation, and he has just recently cheated at the 2012 mock trial tournament. The plaintiff has utterly failed to prove, by preponderance of the evidence, all elements of their case. The opposing counsel has failed to prove that the statement was false in some material respect. There are no phone records to prove there are no phone records to prove that they were discussing allergies. Another element that went unproven today was that the statement was the proximate cause of damages to the plaintiff. The facts show that the plaintiff violated the morals clause. He admitted to that on his cross-examination. And also that the scholarship fund was financially crumbling. They were taking money from family members to pay for it, and they were also in need of donations. We, the defense, believe the plaintiff have failed to meet the burden set before them today. But if you believe that they have met their burden, you must consider our defenses. First is that the alleged statement was truthful. We have proved that MJ Hinken has gathered two sources of information and that he witnessed himself that they were in a posture that looked as though they were texting. Second is that MJ Hinken did not act with actual malice. MJ Hinken did not even know Phoenix Perdante before the trial occurred. Today, you have heard from three witnesses from the defense. MJ Hinken did not commit libel. MJ Hinken told you he saw Phoenix Perdante and Sterling Morton texting back and forth back and forth during the trial. He told you how his statement was not made with actual malice. Also, he told you that he had made a mistake in the past, but that was not the case with this article. You have also heard from Sal Vester. Sylvester told you how he witnessed flagrant cheating. He told you how he saw Phoenix use, he told you how Phoenix's closing argument went better than expected in it, and they won the mock trial tournament because of that closing argument. He also told you that the Dalton Academy mock trial team had their emails hacked and that the hacker was traced back to Alexander Hamilton High School. The third testimony you heard from the defense today was Joe Serpico. Joe told you how signs were all over the courtroom stating cell phones should be turned off during trial. She also announced to everyone to turn off their cell phones. Today, you have also heard from three plaintiff witnesses. Today, you've heard from Phoenix. He admitted that he violated the morals clause. I believe that is grounds for removal of the scholarship to Phoenix Perdante. You've also heard from Sterling Morton today. Sterling Morton admitted that they deleted the text that would help us, to prove this case. And you've also heard from Charlie Connor today. Charlie Connor told you that they had to take donations, and it was a financial hit to the scholarship fund, and that the family had to help fund the closing, had to help fund the scholarship. We feel that the plaintiff has failed to meet their burden of proof, and Phoenix has not learned from his mistakes. We, the defense, ask that you find MJ Henkin not liable for damages caused to the plaintiff. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Bynum, do you have any rebuttal?
Yes, ma'am, I do. Phoenix never texted Sterling. This story of them going back and forth is completely false. The witness statements even say so. And most attorneys know that a great closing argument does not come from a measly text message. It takes a lot of time, a lot of effort, and a lot of passion to do a closing argument. You don't get that from a text message. You get that from hours and hours and hours of work. And when they wrote this article is based on an assumption. This assumption, which could be called a rumor, ruined Phoenix's life. How do we let a rumor ruin somebody's life and an $80,000 scholarship just because a coach is mad he lost? Texting during this tournament is not cheating, as stated in the rules. There was only one text going back and forth. Phoenix today is a good kid. He just wants to go somewhere in life, but now that's ruined because a coach decided that his ego was going to be bigger than a kid's opportunity. Nothing further, Your Honor.
Thank you. All right, well, that concludes the proofs as well as the closing arguments. We, the jury, will be taking a brief recess to discuss, and we are going to return with some critiques. Thank you very much. All right, we are going to have some comments now from the judges, and we are going to mix it up a bit. We are going to start with Judge Davidson.
Well, this was the third and last round. I thought all of you have polished your acts very well, and obviously we're more relaxed and I would say confident. I saw great improvement from the other teams on opening statements and closing statements. Very good organization, very well laid out, describing the elements. As far as what you had to prove or for the defendant, what you were going to not let them prove. Good, straightforward. Good eye contact, good just basic fundamental getting what you had to get in there. The cross-examinations were very good, and some of the witnesses were very, very good. I particularly would give credit to Amos for not flinching and besides after the hammering and hammering by Samantha, I think it was. but I give Samantha credit for me because she really hounded him, but it was kind of a draw, I think, at the end. It kind of reminded me of somebody shooting someone's foot and they're dancing and to get around it. But that's just how that goes, and sometimes you win them, sometimes you don't. Rachel, I know you got lost at one point. Don't worry about that. I mean, we've done that as lawyers in real life cases in front of real life juries. It just happens. You know, something comes in that you weren't expecting, and you know, but you did get get your feet back on the ground. So you know that's a good thing. Don't worry about it. The closing arguments I thought were very, very good. Mark did a really good job of kind of bringing everything very methodically, highlighting what they didn't really show. By the same token, Samantha, your closing was very, very good. And I really kind of gave you extra credit for getting back up and doing a rebuttal and really kind of, you know, throwing some more gas on the fire for your client, and kind of nullifying a little bit of what the defense had thrown up for you. So, and that is so easy just to say, well, you know, I don't have to do anything more, but you did, and you know, and that was good. And also, it was really smart of you to check your time. Mm-hmm. I noticed you did that to see how much time you had. So, I think you paced yourself very well in that, and that's something I would give credit for. So, congratulations. I hope you all do well. And again, it was just a real pleasure to be a judge here. I also want to throw in a good compliment to our judge. Who, I just thought did very well as far as making good rulings in this case and handling things well too.
Oh, thank you so much.
Congratulations. I just want to add what Mr. Davidson said about your hard work. You guys did a great job. I hope you go on to the next rounds, your regionals, because I think both teams were very good and could do that. I would comment, like Mr. Davidson, Samantha, and Mark, you guys did a really good job on closing arguments. You weren't reading. You know, when you read, it kind of distracts from the jury. They kind of fade out when you're just reading. And you guys did a really nice job on that. And on the rebuttal, too, Sandy did a nice job on that. But I want to give some credit to Madison, too. You did a real textbook job of admitting evidence, which is not always easy. You did a great job of smoothly, seamlessly admitting evidence, which is a difficult thing. So I would give some credit to you. That I know you took some time in learning how to do that, especially when the witness said, I don't remember where I was sitting. And then you went right into, well, I got the diagrams. You admitted the diagrams, refreshed that person's memory, and showed them this is where you were sitting. So that's a great thing, and that's what we learn as thinking on our feet, because that was something you had to think on your feet. You couldn't be prepared for the witness saying, I can't remember where I was sitting. So that, a good credit to you, really good. Amos, you're a great witness. I don't know if you do theater or civic theater. See, everybody's nodding. I could tell, because you were a great witness. You didn't always get sidetracked or stick to the yes or no answers, because you don't have to stick to a yes or no answer. Even if the judge instructs you yes or no on redirect, just for future use, redirect, get up there and said, tell the witness. You know, the other attorney wanted to cut you off and made you say yes. You wanted to explain it, didn't you? Yes, I did. What did you want to say? Let him say it. Because yes and no, it tends to irritate the jury sometimes, too. So good job on that, Amos. And just congratulations, everybody. Hope you go on to regionals and move on.
Thank you, Judge Easton.
Speaking of theater, if you run into a situation like that and you've done any acting like that, if you blow your lines, I can't remember what the next line is, just jump into something else. Just get right on. Don't let a lot of silence take over. You know, if you don't get the answer you want, just proceed on to something else, and usually it will work out in the long run. It may hurt somebody else's lines. Someone else, I've forgotten who it was, it may have been Irma, did something that I always dislike, and that is injected herself and said, I wouldn't do that, and my opinion wouldn't be that. They're not asking you for your opinion. You're asking for what the facts are in the case and what the law is and that sort of thing. So try not to inject yourself into too much. And since I neither have to oppose, nor appear in front of the judge, I don't have to give her any compliments.
You'll pay for that later. Judge Brinker.
You did a wonderful job. You all thought on your feet. It was a great show. And I agree with what's been said already. I don't want to repeat too much, but although I think a couple of things are worth repeating, at one point I thought it was the Amos and Samantha show. Both sides did really well there. I would just say maybe at some point you might say, okay, it's time to stop, because I think maybe dragging it on wasn't quite as beneficial to you, but it was a great show. And then also the closings. I think those were the best that I've seen today. Laid that out. Tied everything together, tied your witnesses together. I mean, what a jury sees are just pieces of what you know. You know this story inside and out. The jury doesn't. So it's up to you to put it together and help them to understand it and to also rule in your favor. And you both sides did a really good job on that. Congratulations and good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Judge Armstrong.
Now you get to, I said that after the first session, I'm going to say it after this session, so now you really get to breathe, relax, enjoy the fact that you finished round three, and now you just get to celebrate, because really, you worked very hard, and it showed. We really appreciate, we have the easy job, and we know that. We really appreciate all the time and effort and preparation that you put on to make this happen, so you should be very proud. Your teacher coaches should be very proud. Your attorney coaches should be very proud, because we know you've worked so hard. We're not too short on time, so I want to point out a couple things, because really, you did so many things today that, as a trial attorney, I recognized as really good tactics. So I do firmly believe you both have a good shot to go on to regionals, and I'd like to see you keep working on those things that you need to work on and apply those things that you know are positive things to be doing during the competition, because you all, every single one of you, did something that I think was phenomenal at some point during this round, and I can't always say that in every round, so I would say, Adam, I liked your opening because the words that you used more than anything. First of all, you weren't tied to a script, and you used some really strong language. I wrote down some words. You talked about him being a poor boy, you tied into that theme, the pen is mightier than the sword. Your word choices, when you're a lawyer practicing in front of a jury, your word choices are so important, and you made some very good choices. And Irma, in her opening, you used the rhetorical question. I love using the rhetorical question. I do that all the time in front of juries, because I can't even remember what the question was. Oh, what else would he lie about? If he lied about that, what else would he lie about? And there's just this pregnant pause where, you know, of course he's just a big fat liar, pants on fire, because, you know, that's you've just left it hanging out there. So I think you both did some very technically wise things, and right off the bat from the onset of this case. Madison, you have an amazing presence in the courtroom. You have a better presence than a lot of practicing lawyers, so you should be very proud of that. Even though you had a script, that script can be very distracting for a lot of people. They tend to read it. Because you've read it 100 times, you tend to read it very fast when you're asking that question-answer script with your direct witnesses. But you did not do that at all. You had a very, I was going to say loud voice, not loud in that it was like yelling, but we could all hear you. We could all understand you. So you did definitely make the most use of your direct examination and get some important concessions on your cross. So very good job. Samantha, we all decided, actually we shouldn't say that, I decided that you're probably going to be a prosecutor. Because you know what Judge Brinker was talking about, it might have maybe went on just a little bit too far. But at the same time, you weren't going to let him off the hook either. He was not answering your question, and you wanted him to answer your question. And I got to tell you, as a prosecutor, you got to find that line where, okay, now it's time to stop, because, you know, the jury will start to resent it. But the bottom line is, you definitely showed a commitment to your case, to your side. And I agree with Judge Davidson. I had actually kind of figured out what your score was going to be during your closing. And I bumped it up a point after your rebuttal, because you came back on rebuttal and in a very very concise way, probably one of the best times I've seen, and not just today, but in multiple mock trial tournaments, just concisely said what your issue was. That this poor kid, he's just trying to make it, and it's all based upon a rumor. And it just boiled it right down to, that's your entire case, and you conveyed that very well. So keep that up.
Thank you.
But don't argue with the witnesses. Rachel, I think that you held your composure. You got a little flustered at the podium. Bill has a suggestion regarding, or Judge Easton has a suggestion regarding, you know, when you lose your place or something. I think what happened was the answer wasn't what you expected, and so it kind of threw you off your planned notes. It's okay to say to the court, Your Honor may have a moment, and, you know, not take 5 minutes, but take a moment, find your place, and remember why you're asking the question. Because if you remember why you're asking that question, it'll give you the next question and what you need to get back to. So, but you held your own, and you did a good job. And Mark, you got the best concession of the trial. And while I'm going to give you a lot of credit for getting it, I wanted you to follow up on it. And that was when you were questioning Dakota. You asked him.
Yeah.
Everybody know?
Yeah.
So you knew you didn't measure up to the morals clause.
Yeah.
And he said, yep. And okay, no further questions. Wait a minute. Why are we here? If he doesn't measure up to the morals clause of that scholarship, then what's the point of this case? So you get a lot of credit for getting it, because if it were a real case and you're closing, that's all you'd be talking about. So really good job getting that concession. But remember to listen to the answers and follow up. Every once in a while, that nugget will drop in your lap,
okay,
and you don't want to miss the opportunity.
Yeah.
So good job, everybody.
Judge Buckley.
Well, I don't know that I could say much more than these judges have said. You guys all did a really wonderful job. It's obvious from watching you that you're well prepared. You knew the case. You knew the facts. You knew what you wanted to get in, what you wanted to get out of your witnesses. As the only non-attorney up here, I would say from my perspective, a lot of times in real court, it's a sales job. And that's what you're trying to do. The facts are the facts. You want to get them in, but you want to sell the jury on looking at the case from your perspective and what you're trying to get across to them. And I think one of the things that really it was talked about a little bit, it really wasn't hammered, the feelings of the case. The feelings of from where Phoenix sits, that he's lost all this potential scholarship and his chance to go to college, and the feelings that the other coach had. Salvester, was that the other coach? I don't have my name sheet anymore. The feelings that person had about losing the mock trial and the way they lost the mock trial, how dare anybody beat Belton Academy at this thing we're so wonderful at, though that was a huge part of it. The other thing, as a lay witness or a lay juror, the facts of the case. This is kind of a very intricate legal issue, and maybe we don't understand exactly what slander is or libel or these things. And I think maybe a shot at explaining some of those might have helped a little bit. Might have been something you could have done. I was glad to see that you guys used your time, and the other, I sat in another courtroom earlier today, and man, we were done in 15 minutes, and it just burned through the time. That's bad for a couple reasons. They didn't take an opportunity to get a lot of the facts out or the things that should have been said. The other thing is, when you go really fast, it's hard to understand what you're saying, and you don't know what people are saying, and it just kind of gets all lost in the speed. I did write on here one time, slow down. I want to remind everybody, you know, that's something that that almost everybody has to do. I'm probably doing it right now, talking faster than I should. Slow down and just take your time. Let the words come out. About all I had, there was a lot of things that were said. The same thing, you had that concession, you had that, and I wrote right on here, let them off too easy.
Yeah.
That was my notes on here. That was your time to just, I would have set the pen down and say, come on, here we are, this is it. there was some questioning going on about the fact that the scholarship fund was in financial trouble. Who was it that was trying to? I knew what you were trying to get to, but she kept telling me, "What? No, we had the money. I got the money from my family, so I have it." But you don't have the money. You had to go get it from your family. I think that's the point you're trying to make. It was just a little bit lost there. And that's when I think that's about where I wrote, slow down, take a breath. And I don't know if it's exactly great form during a mock trial, but to tell the judge, could I have a minute to confer with my co-counsel and just walk over to the table events for 10 seconds just to kind of regroup a little bit. But other than those, I don't want to make it sound like it's bad because I think you guys did a really, really wonderful job. I don't know if there's any more I can say. I think you did a great job and we're really proud to watch this.
Thank you.
Thank you. Captain Muxlow, what are your thoughts?
Well, they've kind of said it all. I just want to leave. I'm very, very amazed. In my 32 years of law enforcement, we deal with a lot of negative things that happen in our everyday police work and stuff. And something like this, to see high school students like yourself, these two teams and the other teams that I got to see today, your parents have to be so proud of you, and you need to be proud of yourself. To be able to come in and perform like that, I think, is just amazing. And I want you guys to give yourself a hand, because I think you did a great job.
Thank you. Congratulations. Really, both of you did such a great job. And I just wanted to make a couple of observations. Adam, when you first did your opening, you had wanted to turn the podium around, and unfortunately we're just not equipped to move. You know what? You didn't even need it. I mean, you didn't even, like, look at your notes. I mean, barely. So if you do advance, consider not using a podium at all and making even, like, one step closer to the jury, because honestly, you could have done it. You really could. So you did a great, great opening. Irma, I thought you did a great opening, too. I did make a note between Irma and Rachel that there was a little bit of confusion at the beginning about who was standing up and which is no big deal. I'm confused all the time, but it's okay. But act cool about it. Act like it's no big deal. You know, just try to, you know, go through it. Because when you laugh, it kind of draws attention to maybe you made a mistake. And so just a jury is always paying attention to what you're doing, at least one juror. I think that we find that out of 12 pairs of eyes, there's always one that happens to be looking at you, and then they tell everybody else. So Madison, you received just amazing remarks and commentary and comments about your presentation, textbook handling of exhibits. You were relaxed, and maybe on the inside you were feeling not relaxed, but on the exterior you were very calm and cool and relaxed. So great job. Samantha, you also did a super job with your concessions, I felt like you listened to the witnesses and their responses, and you would follow up, which is so great, because I know that you have scripts or questions that you want to ask, but it's always refreshing to know that you can think on your feet and actually follow up on an answer that a witness gives you. So really good job. And I loved how when you talk about the power of language, Adam, when you were portraying your client as being poor, and then in your rebuttal, you picked up on that and talked about, you know, he's just a poor kid, and you humanized him, that this isn't just a case about dollars and cents. You know, you humanized your client. I thought that was very good, very touching. So I really did like that. Mark, I loved your closing argument. I thought it was so organized. And what a complicated law. I mean, these legal issues are not simple. They're complex. Not only did you start off, I mean, you had just a clear purpose. Hey, they didn't meet their burden. But if you find they've met your burden, then you have to consider our defenses. And affirmative defenses aren't simple. I mean, they're complex, and I thought that you hit on them extremely, extremely competently. I really, really, I could follow along. I understood what you were saying, and I just thought that you really did a terrific job, and I liked the way that you present your case, too. I found the way that you speak or something very soothing. I mean, you have a really nice way about you. I think, Irma, I liked the fact that you tried to qualify a vester as an expert. I mean, that was different, you know? Yeah. I mean, I ruled against you, but I thought that it was, I thought, you know, I gave you points for creativity. I thought that that was something that I hadn't seen yet today, so I liked that. And all of your witnesses, especially the witnesses for the defendant, I thought were really good, really super, and they entertained me, which you get bonus points for. So. Anyway, I want to, I guess, reiterate what Captain Muxlow said about how proud of you your parents must be, and your friends and your relatives, and really, what a job well done, and this will serve you well. What amazing life lessons you've probably learned, and I think that both of you have a really good chance of moving on, and we would love to see that. So congratulations, and that concludes the final round. Thank you. Thank you.